So thank you everyone for coming. Today I'm going to be talking about pivotal response treatment for children with autism spectrum disorders. And I'm going to be talking about a very specific application of pivotal response treatment where kids who are typically developing are actually act as somewhat of an interventionist for the children with autism. So in the literature this is described as peer-mediated pivotal response treatment. So as Dr. Luzician mentioned, I finished my Ph.D. in October. I moved from the East Coast to Vancouver, and I understand that I've got all of the possibly worst weather in a very short amount of time, most consecutive days of rain and lots of snow, but I still think it's lovely here, and I'm really enjoying it, actually. And I'm currently doing a postdoctoral fellowship in the neuropsychiatry clinic and the ADHD clinics, and I'm really much continuing. I have a real interest in applied research and treatment outcome research, and so I'm continuing that work right now with children who have tic disorders and the ADHD. And the work that I'll be talking about today formed the basis of my dissertation, and I bring sort of two different worlds to this kind of work. So I started off with a school psychology master's degree and very much involved in the school system. And then I went on later to do my PhD in clinical psychology. And so I was really quite interested in merging these two worlds when thinking about how to help kids. Because I just think we have these systems that don't really talk to one another. We have an education system who's doing one thing for these children, we get to the hospital setting, they're doing another thing. And so I was sort of really interested in bringing those two. So most of my work to date has been in autism spectrum disorders and working with those children, but I very much have that sort of applied research interest. So today I'm going to be talking about what is peer-mediated pivotal response treatment. I'll talk a bit about the research basis and what's out there. I'll talk about a specific intervention in the actual manual that my research is based upon. I'll talk about my study, and I'll just give you a sense of sort of where that work has gone since that time. I'd just like to get a sense of who's in the room before I start. So raise your hand if you're a student at UBC. Okay, and are you in education, or what fields are you in?
Special education.
Great. Okay, do we have any clinicians in the room who also do some clinical work? Okay, thank you, Paul. Great. Okay. So just, this is meant to be a bit more of an informal style of presentation, so feel free to jump in, ask your questions throughout, that sort of thing. So there will be lots of videos in this talk, so I just want to remind you that the chances are that you will know these individuals is quite small since they're all from the East Coast, but just a reminder, I do have consent to use these videos for presentation purpose, just a reminder that you're not to speak about the kids that you see in the videos outside of this context. So I became interested in trying to think about interventions for individuals with autism in the school system, because what I found is that the bulk of my work and a lot of the research actually is focused really heavily on early intervention, which is really important. We know that the earlier that a child with autism gets intervention and good intervention, with evidence-based components is really important and does really change the trajectory of their skills. But there's little research on if we even know, does early intervention work using applied behavioral analytic principles? Does that even carry over into the new setting of school? So kids with autism have difficulty generalizing, they get to school, there's less research that happens often in a school setting. We often have some sense that kids are getting some form of applied behavioral analysis in school, but it's kind of hard to know what is actually happening. Few people are looking at how well these interventions are delivered. And at least in Nova Scotia, once children with autism got to school, there was very little good intervention that was systematically evaluated in schools. And so I was interested in understanding what could be a really cost-effective evidence-based intervention that we could put in place in the very first year of school that would give kids a chance to really form those social connections, get some skills, and really boost up their skills that could possibly change the trajectory of their social relationships. And I was interested in bringing the clinical psychology and the school psychology and educational psychology and special education fields together to really help these kids. And so, has anyone here, have people heard of PEMO response treatment? So I see some nods, okay. And from what I've learned, I recently gave this presentation at the autism community training, and from what I understand, there's actually very little pivotal response treatment happening in BC. Whereas in Nova Scotia, that is all children under the age of 5 who get a diagnosis of autism will receive a year-long early intensive behavioral intervention that is based in pivotal response treatment. And essentially, pivotal response treatment is an approach that's evidence-based and empirically supported, and it uses principles of applied behavioral analysis. And the context is all done in the natural settings. So I've also worked as a discrete trial clinician as well, and that's a bit more sort of you go through various skills, you teach them sequentially. And pivotal response treatment really has what the core kind of target is: functional communication. And the idea behind pivotal response treatment is that if you target that functional communication as a main primary target, then other skills will come along in a collateral fashion. So even though you might target functional communication, receptive language just comes along even though it's not directly taught. And even behavior problems tend to decrease, even though we didn't explicitly target that behavior problem. And I think of PRT a way like a domino. So if you have kind of one kind of main area like functional communication, if you hit that domino, then all the other skills sort of come along. And the other key component of PRT that's important for you to think about is that the naturalistic piece is really a core part of that treatment approach. So instead of doing interventions in a clinic setting that doesn't really look like the child's home environment or the school setting, it's really meant to be integrated into the child's day-to-day life. And when we think, an early intervention, their day-to-day environment is preschool, it's their home, it's when they're cooking dinner, they're incorporating that kind of technique within that. But when kids get to school, they're actually spending, most of their time, almost 80% of their day, in the school setting. So, I was quite motivated to think, how can we bring these techniques into the real setting that they're going to be there? Because they're going to get way more intervention in the schools if we have people doing PRT on an ongoing basis. And they're going to be in school for a long time. And so PRT is also very interested in sort of incorporating child's interests and motivation into what is being taught. And so this is really the foundation, these pivotal areas. So motivation, attention, multiple choices. And really, motivation is the key part. So in other types of approaches, you might choose some sort of reinforcer, like a Smartie or some sort of food kind of idea. Whereas in PRT, you look, what is the child naturally gravitating toward? It could be a strength on the ground. It could be they're really motivated for some sort of toy that's on the ground. And so the interventionist is going to be following the child's lead and really using that toy, gaining shared control of that toy, and getting the child to make some sort of vocalization or utterance to get that. And if the child decides they're not interested in that object anymore, then they're going to follow the child's lead to the next piece. So that motivation is really key. So when we turn to what my study was really looking at, my study was looking at a specific application of this, which is peer-mediated. So essentially, the child with autism is paired with an interventionist who will be trained in a version of pivotal response treatment. And I'll get more into what that specifically looks like. But just know that it has the same sort of elements. So we're still really based in those applied behavior analytic principles. We're still using very naturalistic principles. And we're focused on key motivational areas like motivation and attention. The other piece to know is that this is all done in the context of play. So even though we're in the school system, there's a lot of, in the first year of school, there's a real curriculum focus on play now, a play-based curriculum, which actually worked out quite well when I was trying to get this study into the school system. Even 5 years ago when the early education curriculum didn't have as much of a play focus, this would have been a lot harder to sell. But really helping people understand that it looks like play. It looks like really good play when you're looking at this intervention, but it's really some key skills that are being taught. So, again, I have a lot of people ask, because in Nova Scotia we have an early intervention curriculum that's based in pivotal response treatment, but that pivotal response treatment is having an adult who is then working with the child with autism and doing the intervention. And so they would often say, well, so what actually is this peer implemented PRT? Because sometimes they would incorporate kids into their pivotal response training, but this is really different. So this is an adult training, typically developing 5 to 6 year olds in basic pivotal response strategies. So the child themselves is actually becomes a bit of that interventionist. And that's very different than just incorporating peers when you're trying to teach another skill. And so you can think, when you get to the school system, there's no funds. People are all strapped for time. And so I'm also thinking, when I was trying to do this work, what is also a practical, feasible, logistical thing that we can do to get these kids' social skills boosted up with, you know, being feasible. And so children, when you think of peers as an interventionist, and typically developing children, first of all, importantly, they're naturalistic. So who is more natural as an interventionist than these children? And when you think of our typical models, we're almost reducing one whole generalization step. So if I'm the interventionist, I'm teaching the child a specific skill or doing PRT, then I need to then transfer that skill to the real environment with the real child. This almost takes that whole piece out, where I'm working with the child and the child, the peer coach and the child with autism all in one step. So it's more naturalistic, it takes away that generalization step. The kids actually can do a better job at modeling play than I could. So that's another really big important, you know, we all like to think, hey, as clinicians we know stuff and we're trained and all these pieces, but I mean, these children that I work with, they just put me to shame in how beautifully they can understand naturalistic, typical play that's appropriate to that school. And so I think that's something that we really have to kind of wrap our heads around thinking about intervention in this way. And, you know, when we think of cost effectiveness, we have lots of typically developing peers in the school system who are really eager to be helpers and have really enjoyed this kind of experience. So that's another piece to think about when we're thinking about this work. So I think the answer to this question, do we see this kind of intervention in schools? It sounded like that there's not much PRT happening in BC, let alone in the school system, and certainly in Nova Scotia, there was no peer-mediated PRT happening in the school. Sometimes there'd be elements of PRT incorporated in various special education classrooms if somebody had a specific interest in that. We are seeing some PRT starting to come to the schools, so we have Alvin Stommer and Shrivman and colleagues, they put up a book recently that talks about full classroom applications of PRT. So there's some really interesting literature around that piece. There's also been some literature looking at how well can EPAs or educational assistants implement PRT in schools. So there's been some sort of movement towards thinking about these kinds of things again, because the naturalistic piece really, it makes a lot of sense for bringing it to the school system. But there's very little research and very little actual PRT done in clinical settings at this point, at least in Nova Scotia. So as part of my dissertation, I started to understand how much research actually is there on this specific application. And so I did a systematic review that looked at this literature, and it turns out it's quite small. So there have only been 5 studies to date that have done a peer-mediated pivotal response treatment study. So all show that their peer-mediated intervention is effective in terms of it increases social behaviors. They looked at various outcome measures, but all have shown that they improve some element of their social behavior. But there hasn't been, you know, these have been small case studies, so there's been 2 children often in each of these studies. They're all single subject design. And the children are in grade 3, so most are 7 to 10 year olds. And the research really looks at, some have had one child who is the what I call the play coach or the peer coach, who's the interventionist. Some studies have had 2 play coaches for the one child with autism. And the idea is that they're really teaching the children with autism to better play and interact. And so while this was shown to be sort of a promising approach, there isn't yet enough research basis to say that this is an evidence-based approach or even a promising evidence-based approach. And I was also curious, when I looked at that research, there were some gaps that were identified. So it tended to be children who were a bit older. There's none that looked at that first year of school, which I thought was a really key piece that I wanted to look at, because when you think of generalizing to a new environment and all of those generalization difficulties, there also wasn't very much information about the peer coaches or the interventionists themselves. So are they enjoying the experience? Do they like being a peer coach? There was very little information on how well those kids actually learn the strategies. So fidelity was not measured at all, which we all know is a really important element of intervention-based research. And again, we do not have enough evidence basis at this point to say whether this is an evidence-based approach. We know that PRT as an approach to intervention is evidence-based and has lots of empirical support, but this specific application of PRT, we can't yet say that. So a really key important part of the work that I did was really, and again, this, you can't put this down in a research paper per se, but was making connections with the school board and really spending time getting to know the school board people, getting to know who is there on the autism team, and saying, look, I have this intervention, we have this approach, what do you think about that? And so this research education partnership is not something that's often happens, but I think that as researchers or as clinicians, it's really something we need to move toward. Because we design these studies that are RCTs, which are beautiful, and they show lovely, empirically validated support, but then we have a real, there's a lag of 8 to 10 years until we get, an evidence-based approach into real practice. And so, my push is to start thinking about how can we combine really good scientific, empirical studies with real-world environments, and how can we merge those two areas sooner. And so the initial stage of my research was an integrated knowledge translation study. So I actually spoke to principals, teachers, special education teachers, I spoke to parents of children with autism. I spoke to parents of typically developing children, and I had a master's student who we worked with in the school psychology department who also talked to children with autism themselves about what would you think about a peer-mediated kind of approach. And we looked at, we brought them the idea of this intervention and said, what do you think in general about evidence-based approaches? What are your thoughts on pivotal response treatment? What are your recommendations for intervention? And a range of themes came across in the integrated knowledge translation process. And I don't have time to highlight them all, but just to give you a sense of the different areas that we talked about, we wanted to know, what should we be targeting in schools? Where in the school should we be doing that? Should we be doing it in the classroom? Should we be doing it in the playground? Should we be doing it, in the morning, in the afternoon? Should we be doing it in the classroom with the other children? So we really were sort of thoughtful about thinking about those kinds of questions. And one thing that I wanted to highlight was, when we first started talking to schools and principals and teachers, people were quite concerned about, well, what about these peers, these intervention agents? What about these kids who will go on to be play coaches? And educators were quite divided. When we looked at the data, we looked at the quality, this is a qualitative study, we looked at the qualitative themes. Some people thought that it was a great idea, it made sense, it was quite naturalistic. Others were worried that it would be, what kind of level of responsibility would it be for these children? And they had an idea that the intervention might be quite onerous for that child, and they were quite worried about that. And so that gave us information that we need to do a bit more education around what PRT looks like and that's done in the context of play. And just to highlight a few of the quotes that we had here. So one of the barriers that people noted is that provided there's not a burden put on the child, again, there's just this idea that, are we asking them to do too much? And in terms of benefit, one of the illustrated quotes, I believe this was a behavioral interventionist in the school system, noted, there are better models than we can be just because they talk in that language. Sometimes we train some of these kids and you can tell that they've been trained. I'm so mindful of that when I work with kids. Oh, I just created a mini-me, didn't mean to do that. You know, you can probably think of experiences where you've had a certain tone that you said a phrase or you used a really adult level, high level language, and then all of a sudden the child with autism is repeating back something that would really, you know, not be cool at all when they're talking to their friends. And so that certainly, people in the school saw that as a benefit, having a naturalistic intervention agent. And just to highlight another one of the really interesting findings that came out of that qualitative work, is we asked children with autism who were around 12 years old to think back to the time when they were in the first year of school, and would they actually want to be trained in social skills by someone who's their age, or would they want to be trained by someone who's older than them? Just to get a sense of, no one's really asked these kids, what do you think about this kind of social intervention approach? And what was interesting is that a really strong theme that came out is that most children with autism do not want to be trained by someone older than them. That was really surprising to both Dr. Isabel Smith and I, because you think of the school system, there's lots of things that are set up where we get an older child to work with a younger child with autism, or you think like book buddies, where you have an older child who's kind of working with a younger child. And at least in this sample, the children with autism really felt uncomfortable with the idea of someone older than them teaching them social skills. So they said things like, when we had buddies with like older kids, I felt so uncomfortable. They sometimes had difficulty articulating why that made them uncomfortable, but certainly that uncomfortable feeling was there. The other child mentioned, I would probably leave the older kids out because they may not feel comfortable talking to someone older than them unless the older kid is family. I just don't think that practicing with an older kid is a good idea. So that sort of provided some context for thinking about things moving forward. So we did a qualitative study after all these questions of the intervention before we did the intervention. We used that information to inform how we modified the intervention that was already in the literature. So we did things like modify the time of day based on what teachers said would be a good time of day to come and do the intervention. Morning, as we all know, most of us learn better in the morning, especially kids in the first year of school. I'm preaching to the choir here that, you know, language in the school system is a really big deal. So having the right lingo for what we call this program tended to help buy-in, which is interesting. So they very much decided that this program, there's a program called Book Buddies in the schools that I was working in. And so we decided to call this approach in the schools Play Buddies, and that's what it was known as. And the interventionists, instead of calling the children who are typically developing interventionists, we call them play coaches. So it was very much introduced in the context of, you know, you have a soccer coach who, you know, teaches you how to kick the ball and what to do and cheers you on. And so these children were, you know, selected because they were really great at playing. And there's some kids that have trouble playing. And we all have strengths and weaknesses. And you're going to really help someone learn how to play and cheer them on just like a coach. And so that was very much the language that we use. And I'll use the word play coach for the rest of the presentation just to keep And then when you can see throughout the presentation, just referred to the research trainer, the adult trainer, that was me in this study. We've continued this work on, and so there's other people who are doing some of this work, but for the purpose of the rest of the talk, that person was me. So I'll just give you a sense of what the intervention looks like before I actually describe my study. So the child with autism is paired with the play coach. And they also were paired with a child who was not trained at all. So the play coach was trained in a PRT-based application. And there was also another child in the same class, so they were all classmates of the child with autism, who was part of the study but that never received any of the training. And we did the study in an empty classroom. So initially we were going to try to do this more in the classroom or on the playground, but it just became a bit of an ethical nightmare when it came to video recording. So we all know there's lots of really great ecologically valid data you can get outside, but then other kids run into the frame and we don't have permission to use that data. So as a next step, we started with the empty classroom. And we used a standardized set of toys that's in the literature, and we looked at 10-minute video segments of these kids playing. So we looked at the various social skills, which I'll talk about in a moment. Before the intervention happened, directly after the intervention, and 6 to 9 weeks following the intervention. And I also found it was really important to get normative data. So what I mean by that is I put the play coach and the generalization peer together in the same standardized setting, the same toys, and saw how they played together. Because I didn't want to hold the child with ASD to a higher standard than what was typical in my class. So, you know, even typically developing children, you're not going to see them playing together 100% of the time. And so that's really important to think about when you're doing your work and doing your research, is what's kind of normative for that particular child in that particular context. So here's an example of some of the training toys that we use. And this is the standardized list that's used in the literature, in the very, very small literature that exists. So just a range of both sort of play sets involving dolls and cars, as well as some more cause and effect based toys, also balls and that sort of thing. So there was a bit of a range. So the actual training itself is based on a manual by Karen Pierce and Laura Schreibman. And the manual that they had made had 10 strategies. Well, between 8 and 10 strategies. And I whittled those strategies down, and I chose 6 of those strategies because I was working with a younger population. I didn't want to teach too many strategies. And I used the most commonly found ones that were in the literature. So this is really a research-based decision off of my systematic review. And the 6 strategies that were involved, which I will go into more detail on, were paying attention, child choice, encouraging conversation, taking turns, this idea of reinforcing attempts, and narrating play. All of these strategies were taught in the context of play. And the children received training across 3 weeks. It was consecutive days. I only ever came in for 20-minute sessions. You think of the attention span of someone who's in the first year of school, 20 minutes to teach a new skill is kind of ideal. There was 8 sessions that I only worked with just the typically developing child. And I taught them the strategies. They had their own visual manual that they learned these strategies in. We did some role play. And when we think about pivotal response treatment, it's really focused on pivotal key areas that we know are going to produce the most change. And for this particular application of PRT, the pivotal areas of this treatment that cut across all of those 6 strategies are attention, so making sure you have the child with autism's attention, and motivation. So what are they motivated in a play environment? So if you look at the training format, so I would explain the strategies to the typically developing child, then the play coach would explain the strategies back to me. I would model those strategies and show them examples using the actual toys that they would eventually be using. And then we had a lot of role play that's happening. And then the final stage would be that they would be paired with the child with autism to then apply those strategies. And at that point then there would be 8 sessions with the child with autism and the play coach. And I would then coach the play coach. So I would sort of be standing back and sort of jump in as needed to kind of facilitate that play. So the play coach would have about 10 minutes to try with guided, facilitated, peer-mediated PRT instruction, and then 10 minutes to try it out on their own. And that was rotated back and forth. So I'll just give you a little bit more of a sense of the actual strategies. So the play coach got a manual that had no words, it just had these pictures, and we would go through 6 of these strategies. So the very first strategy is paying attention. And this is really, I don't have data on, and I don't think we even know a lot of data in the autism world on what are core strategies or core mechanisms. We have information on treatment packages that we know if we do all of these pieces in a systematic way with good fidelity that intervention tends to work. We haven't yet disentangled what are sort of core strategies, but if we think of attention as a core strategy, because you think of children with autism who have many attention difficulties, so you think of difficulty shifting attention, difficulty integrating multiple cues in their environment, difficulty orienting their attention. And so this was a really key strategy that I really focused on with the play coach, is making sure that you get the child with autism's attention, because they're just missing on so many social cues in that first year of school and opportunities to learn about play just by watching the other kids play, because they're not tuned in to what's happening. And even think of a typically developing child who's watching TV, or maybe your partner or someone in your life is watching TV, and it's like they're so zoned into the television that you can't get their attention until sometimes you stand right in between the child and the television. So it was very much teaching the play coach that is sort of the approach to do as a very first step. She also, as you can see in that video clip, that she also offered him choices. So again, a core component of PRT is this idea of choice, child choice, following a lead and child choice. Because if you don't give something to the child that they're really motivated to work for, social skills are challenging as is. So really teaching these play coaches that they need to think about, how do we know what the child with autism is interested in? How can you tell? What do you notice? And making sure one of those choices is part of that. We also teach the children to make sure they hold the visual. So it's one thing to say, hey, do you want a car or a book? That's not going to be as effective in getting the child with autism engaged as if you hold up the visual model of these toys. So you could see in that last example that she did that very well. And so I'll show you a video clip of the next piece that the play coach is offering a choice between two different baby bottles. The third strategy is about facilitating conversation and getting language as much as possible. So really trying to facilitate that speech. And so we talk about making sure they try to get the child with autism to talk for any toy they want. So if you have a ball, hanging on to that ball until the child uses the word ball. Once you have a toy, you really want to encourage and talk about aspects of the toy. So again, you're modeling that piece. So taking turns with the fourth strategy. And just to point out that taking turns is something that all kids struggle with at some point. This is not just a child with autism kind of thing. It's developmentally normal for there to be a bit of difficulty sometimes with this skill. And so I was a bit curious about how this would work with kids in the first year of school. Or is it a bit more of that egocentric thing happening? But you know, they did a really nice job. And you think of children with autism who get stuck, and you hear all the time, like, oh, they just can't stand to lose, or they really want to win all the time. And so then that really interferes with their social relationships, because who wants to play with, you know, the kiddo who always wants to win? Then they're excluded. And so it's an opportunity to model sharing. It's an opportunity to also, the child has to talk to get their turn back. So it's also a great opportunity to kind of teach skills and make sure that language piece is happening. And just an opportunity to model that appropriate play piece. So in the next video, you'll see a child with autism and a play coach who are beautifully taking turns. This is sort of after this has been taught. You may even have trouble distinguishing which one is the child with autism and the play coach. Strategy 5 is really all about this idea of really reinforcing attempts at play. So social skills are tough, and play is tough for a lot of these kids that we work with. And so this is really getting at the idea of reinforcing good play or attempts at play. So they may not be great at certain play aspects. I teach the play coach to really reinforce any attempts at kind of functional play. And the strategy was also intended to make sure that the play coach is having fun too. So, you know, sometimes they warn in the manual that you have to be careful that they don't get too caught up in getting the strategies right, and you really have to have that nice facilitative experience, because if both aren't having fun, then this is not going to be an effective intervention. And so it also gets at that idea from PRT to reinforce attempts and reinforce approximations of what you kind of want to see. So the next clip is quite quick and brief, but what happens, you might not be able to hear it, but what happens is the little girl praises pushing the car down the ramp, because this little boy was just sort of repetitively moving things and not using toys in a functional way. And she very softly, you'll see it, says, she says, nice push. The sixth strategy is narrating play. And so when you think of observational learning and all those kinds of pieces, by having the play coach just describe what they're doing. I am driving the car around the maze. the child, or the doll is swinging on the swings. The girl is, making pie in the play stove. I am taking off the baby's hat. So by really describing these things out loud, you're also getting the child to orient their attention. So you're drawing them into what they're doing. You're modeling and giving them words to describe the play that they may not already learn. So now that you have a sense of what the intervention looked like, I'll talk about the core intervention study that formed the part of my dissertation. We're currently working on writing that up right now with the expert advice and input from Dr. Luzician, who's here, who's been instrumental in sort of shaping this paper. But overall, what I was interested in is, can we actually train typically developing classmates of children with autism to do this application of PRT? Like, is this even possible? This is the youngest group that's really been looked at for this particular application. And if we train these kids, and can they learn it, does it improve the social skills of children with autism in the first year of school? So research question one was just looking at this idea of fidelity of PRT implementation by the play coaches. And the second research question was, do the social skills of children with autism in the first year of school improve? So I looked at percentage of peer engagement, which is how much does the diet interact with one another. Engagement was defined as the child with autism being in proximity, 5 feet or as appropriate for the activity, and they're participating in a social activity. So talking, playing a game, stuffing things together, that piece. And it was continuous coding. And we generated a percentage. So it was like, did they interact 100% of the time, 0% of the time, what percentage? We also looked at rates of initiations in 10-minute segments. So this was, how often did the child with autism actually initiate a verbal interaction that was unprompted? And we looked at the rate of that per minute. And then the third question that I was interested in, again, I'll spend less time on the third question for the purpose of this presentation, but I will touch on it briefly, was, does, what do these play coaches think about being part of this intervention? And does it impact, does any part of this intervention impact on their own social behavior? I also looked at things like their attitudes towards disabilities following this intervention. Because that was another piece that really came out of the qualitative integrated knowledge translation study, was that principals liked the idea, and so did parents, of both children with autism and typically developing children. They liked this idea that the typically developing children can benefit a lot from this as well. And it can create sort of a harmonious environment in that first year of school and set up the idea that we help those who are different than us, and maybe they're not so different after all. You think of the first year of school as such a formative period where people are forming perceptions, social networks are just starting to form, so if we can get in there and sort of change these perceptions and give some skills to the children with autism at the same time, how does that change the trajectory of the social dynamics in that school or that classroom or for those children in years to come? It was a single subject study, meaning that there was smaller groups of children. And so there was 4 children with autism, and their parents and teachers also participated by way of questionnaires. And there were 4 play coaches who were the classmates of children with autism. And their parents and teachers also filled out questionnaires about their social skills and overall behavior. And then we also had non-trained generalization peers. Again, these are the kids who did not receive any training in PRT, but were then paired with the child with autism after intervention to see if they generalized skills to someone who wasn't trained in this application. And the way that these children were selected, so the children with autism were selected, I also like to point out that the children with autism had all received a 1-year PRT training in preschool period before they went to school. So the interventionist in the preschool program that happens in Nova Scotia, a publicly funded preschool program, helped us select peers they thought would be ideal for this study. We don't know a lot about the kinds of peers or the kinds of children with autism who would benefit most from this work. We're still learning about that. But what the literature had shown was that ideally they have some functional communication. And again, usually a bit more of the higher functioning children are the ones who've been involved in this work up to this point. And what the literature showed in terms of selecting play coaches is that we don't have a lot of information about this. And I think it's a really interesting research idea about trying to understand this piece a bit better moving forward. You know, even in the larger autism literature, we have a little information about the therapeutic alliance and therapeutic match between adult interventionists even and children with autism. And so we use what was done in the literature, which is teachers. Teachers are sort of the best people who kind of know what's happening in the classroom, have a sense of what kind of child might be the best suited. And so the basic criteria was teachers chose and the child had to actually attend school. You know, it could be a child who was, you know, wasn't there a lot, didn't attend. And the children with autism, I'd also like to point out that they were also, any child who had a lot of externalizing behavioral problems were also excluded from the study. Not to say that those children couldn't benefit in the future, but for the purpose of trying to understand, you know, we didn't want to give the play coaches behavior problems that had to be managed first before they actually got the intervention. So all the children with, this is a baseline, all of the children with autism were male. And as you can see, child one and two were relatively able in terms of their language, skills, their cognitive abilities. And child three and child four were a bit lower functioning in these areas. And actually you can see child four, who was actually kind of the lowest functioning in the sample, and I was actually the most worried about this kiddo because he didn't match what has been shown in the small literature in terms of children who might benefit from this kind of approach. He also was having very little functional speech in the class. Like the teacher had heard him speak in the class aloud. He had to whisper sometimes in her ear, and he did not spontaneously speak to the other children. And so I was most worried about this kiddo, but in the end, I'm quite glad he was part of the study, and you'll see that he made some quite nice gains. So all the children were six. The play coaches, I don't have their data up here, but the play coaches were on average 5 years old. So I looked at, the very first question I was interested in is, this was not even looked at in the study, the fidelity of implementation. So, you know, and by the way, this is something that's often forgotten in the literature as well. We're moving much more in the autism intervention field to look much more closely at fidelity. But I looked at, and I wasn't the one who's coded this, somebody who is trained in PRT and early intervention team looked at how well is the play coaches, how well and how often are they actually implementing those six strategies that I showed you. And this is just averages across all children, across baseline phase, post-intervention and follow-up. But you can see here that at baseline, on average, the children were implementing these strategies about 40% of the time. And that was higher, actually, than we thought that it might be. That number is actually skewed a bit by one child who, at baseline, was implementing PRT strategies almost 70 to 75% of the time before we taught them anything. So, I mean, this is pretty fascinating. And Isabel, Dr. Smith and I are quite interested in this sort of idea that there might be some kids who naturally have a lot of these skills, and how can we find these kids, and how can we kind of better use them in the school system? So that is just a really fascinating thing in and of itself. Of course, it skewed our data, but I was really excited to see, excited to see that. So all children improved their fidelity of implementation, and after training, they did increase to a level that was sort of the 75% criterion that is suggested in the literature for this technique. And we had good inter-observer agreement as well, so about 84% inter-observer agreement. So the next piece that I'm going to talk about is, do the social skills of these children improve following this intervention approach? So the first data set I'm going to show you is looking at the percentage of peer engagement. So again, this is this idea of interactive play between the child with autism and the play coach. They're within proximity, they're doing kind of socially appropriate interaction, whether it's talking together, playing a game, creating something together. The inter-class correlations for that data was quite good. So it was 0.99, so this data is pretty clear. So we looked at 33% of the videos across phases, across each experimental phase to code that piece. So just to get a sense of how this works. So across the x-axis there are the observation sessions. And this is a non-concurrent, multiple baseline, multiple probe design across participants. So you'll often see in the education field that this idea of non-concurrent happens quite a bit because it was me doing the same study. I couldn't start all at the same time. And also the multiple probe idea, so that I'm not taking, I would take probes every 3, 5, 6, and 9, and the baselines extended from 1 to 3 weeks. And we looked across participants. And so the observation sessions are on the x-axis, and then on the y-axis, you'll see percentage of peer engagement. So 100% will be the child with autism, the play coach, were engaged 100% of the time. You'll also see that there is a horizontal line across the graphs. And that line represents the normative data. So that is when the generalization peer and the play coach were put in the same classroom setting that you saw with the same toys, given no instruction, and you saw how often they interacted and followed that same dependent variable criterion. And you can see that on average, it's around that 74% mark that typically developing peers across these schools were engaged in the same scenario about 74% of the time. So that helps give you kind of an idea of where the children with autism were at. And then there were three experimental phases. So we have baseline, we have post-training, and we have the follow-up phase. And so we look to see across the phases whether there's changes in level, trend, variability, to determine if there's a functional relationship between these skills and the introduction of intervention. So just to give you a sense here, so we have child 1, 2, 3, and 4, and again these were dyads as well though, but we are coding the percentage of time that these children were engaged together. You'll see the horizontal axis, which is the normative, what most kids who are typically developing sort of engage in. You'll see that child 1, child 3, and child 4 showed changes, and there was a functional relationship for that percentage of peer engagement for those children. Child 2 was looking really good with their play coach from the beginning. Child 2 also had the play coach who at baseline had like 75% natural peer team fidelity skills. So it's like, these things happen. It's great that they happen because now we know that these kids do exist, and we're still thinking about how to best select these kiddos. And what's interesting to see is you can see many of the kids look as good, or sometimes even a little bit better, than typically developing peers in terms of how often they were engaged with one another. So we also looked at, I'm going to show you data from the generalization peer. So these data are a bit more messy, as you can see, but the red lines represent what happens when the child with autism was paired with the child who did not get any training in PRT in the same classroom. And so we see, we see some nice gains certainly by follow-up, but in terms of the actual functional relationship there, that data is a bit more murky. And then we did take some probes that we can't interpret. It's interesting clinically. We did take some probes in non-training locations. So we took the child with autism and the play coach to to a room that we didn't see at all during training, that was new to them, and just looked at how well they interacted in a new environment, because we know that that generalization piece is a bit tricky. So again, interesting because it seemed to kind of translate to a new classroom, but because we don't have baseline data, we can't interpret that from a research perspective in too strong of a way.
Were the same toys provided in that environment?
Yeah, thanks for asking that. Yeah, same. Same toys. I'm afraid to touch anything.
Gremlins.
We had a heck of a time getting it up initially. Yeah, so same toys, but just a brand new environment. So the next question that I was interested in is this idea of initiations. And we know from the literature that initiations is a lot harder to teach these kids. So we're really great in the autism intervention world at teaching them to be great responders, responding to things. So the initiations piece is more challenging. And PRT is sort of one of these approaches that's known for being a bit better at getting initiators than some other types of approaches. So we're going to be looking at students with autism, their rate of initiations made towards typical peers, the play coach. And again, these are non-prompted, independent, spontaneous, verbal, social communication. And so the total number of tallies of how many times they actually initiated was divided by the length of the session. And so we got this rate of initiation per minute. Again, the interclass correlations for this variable that was coded was quite good as well, 0.95. Here we see that there are basic effects for child 3 and child 4, and then the data for child 2 and child 1 is a bit messier. So we can't say that there's a functional relationship here for the initiations because we only have two demonstrations, child three and child four. Again, we have child two who was looking pretty good at the beginning and that great play coach at the beginning already had all the skills. And child one, they had sort of a variable profile, but by follow-up, they looked quite good. And it was sort of interesting, child one, he was not interacting with any of his classmates during indoor recess. He would be sitting at his table and doing his book work, whereas all the other children would be playing together. But for whatever reason, when he was paired with this one-on-one interaction, he did quite well at baseline, depending on the day, but certainly improved by follow-up. Okay, so then we just look, the red lines are again the child with autism who is with the generalization peer. And again, we really, we see two basic effects here in terms of generalizing with child three and child four. And these data are a bit more messy, but we are seeing some presence of generalization with children who are not trained. And again, we took some probes in non-training locations, which kind of, it follows generally the same trajectory at post-training and follow-up, but we don't have baseline data on that piece. So that's what the data showed, and then just to give you a sense of what the actual videos show, because I find that piece really enriches what the data shows. So I'll take you through a child's example of intervention. So I'll show you a baseline video clip, immediately following training, and then at that 6 to 9 week follow-up. The third question I was interested in was, does participation in this peer-mediated fiddle response treatment affect the behavior of the play coaches? So again, I really brought this question in just because it's a common question we get from administrators, from parents, that sort of piece. And so we looked at teacher ratings of social skills of the play coaches before and after intervention, parent ratings of social skills. We looked at adaptive functioning, daily living skills before and afterward. And we looked at attitudes towards disabilities. So for the most part, these behaviors slightly increase from a social skills perspective. I'm thinking of a child with autism. So the play coaches, their behavior actually stayed the same. So there's no negative impact on their participation in this intervention. And while that may not sound that exciting, that's actually quite important information for thinking about peer-mediated approaches with these kiddos. There was no change in their attitudes towards children with disabilities before and after intervention, but as it turns out, these kids had quite, the play coaches who participated and even the generalization peers who looked at their attitudes before and after intervention, they had quite positive attitudes towards disabilities at the get-go. And we also looked at satisfaction. So how much did they enjoy being part of this work? Think of selecting measures for children who can't read yet. Happy face skills are really important. And so we have here that on a scale of 1 to 5, on a happy face scale, play coaches were very satisfied with their time in the intervention. And I actually had a parent of one of the play coaches kind of stop me and find me at the school system one day. She was trying to find where I was. To stop me and say, thank you so much for giving my child the opportunity to be in this role of a play coach, because I'm so proud of their ability to do this, and I really realized there's so much more beyond academics, and I was so touched that you saw my child as someone who can do this role, and she talked so many positive things about having been part of this intervention. And it's interesting because I was at a conference, and Philip Strain, who's sort of like the person who's done most work on peer-mediated interventions broadly, he was talking about his long-standing work in this field, and he said that once the word gets out that parents of typically developing children like having their kids be part of this, he said he has lineups of wait lists of parents of typically developing children who want their children to be part of this kind of program. And he's done this work for many, many years. So 20 years later, he's still followed what happens to these play coaches, and then they go on to actually be interventionists or teachers and that sort of thing later on down the road. So it's sort of interesting to think about that piece. So just to summarize, can children as young as 4 to 6, because that was the other question. It's like, okay, come on, like, can you really teach PRT to a 4 to 6-year-old? And this study would suggest that a specific application that sort of whittled down to these 6 kind of core strategies, that yes, 3 of 4 of them were able to increase their implementation of these skills to an established criterion in the literature. One of them had really great skills from the beginning, and that's clinically meaningful as well. And then in terms of, does this intervention improve the social behavior of children with autism? So we really did show a functional relationship between this and the intervention for peer engagement. 3 of the 4 children did improve in terms of peer engagement. It did not have a functional relationship for social initiation. So only 2 of those children showed a basic effect in terms of increases in initiations. And then the final question was just around this idea, is this potentially harmful for the play coaches? Is there any impact on their behavior? And they were all satisfied with the experience. And so I didn't present this data, but so were we did parent satisfaction, we did teacher satisfaction. The teacher satisfaction data is really important as well. And the teachers were okay with having us in the classroom, and they really were part of this process, and because we engaged them in an integrated knowledge translation framework and a very much research education framework, I believe that's also partly why that we had buy-in from this. And we also really tried to understand what was feasible for the school environment and infuse research within that piece. And so certainly there was no impact in terms of negative impact on the children's behavior. So just some qualitative notes. School was very happy to have us there. They keep inviting us back. My doctoral supervisor, Dr. Isabel Smith, said, like, I was never even able to get into the school system very much for even the most basic study. And now they're inviting us back to the school system to partner with them on multiple projects because we had this positive working relationship that showed it could be mutually beneficial for both parties. When you think of outcomes for children with ASD, you ask parents, you know, we as researchers have these definitions that we want to look at and measure for good reason. Initiations are really important in terms of long-term outcomes and that kind of piece. But if you ask any parents that you work with, what do you really want for your kids? They said, you know, I want my kid to get invited to stuff. I want them to get invited to birthday parties. And what just kind of a really interesting thing that just happened on camera a couple of times is two of the children with autism received birthday party invites in the context of the study, which was really sweet. Child three and four, the little female play coach, the teacher there reported that little girl was implementing these strategies on recess, on the playground, and not just with the child with ASD, but also with other children who were suspected of having like FASD and a few other challenges. She was out there providing choice and trying to get their attention and incorporate them in the games. So that was kind of interesting to hear about. And then child four, like we're still getting three years at this point later, we're still getting reports that those two little boys in the baby bottles are still interacting with one another, which is lovely. And then it wasn't just, we also heard from various other settings in the school, like speech-language pathologists, Nova Scotia, we call them learning centers, just, you know, sort of a resource kind of room, that there was increased spontaneous communication in new environments in the school that they hadn't seen before the intervention. So I think this study just really highlights the value of a research-education partnership. And I think, you know, a lot of you here in education, I really think there's so much value in as much as possible kind of bringing your work to the real school environment and then also engaging as much as, I think, as research, you know, education and hospital systems don't talk well to one another, so even bringing those partnerships as much as possible, there's really a lot of value in that, in those kinds of partnerships. And I think that's kind of the next place that we need to be going as a field. And I think what's neat about this is that very relatively brief training in this application of PRT produced some really notable gains for children with autism in a really cost-effective, naturalistic approach that cut out the second step of having an adult teach and then trying to generalize to peers. So we went right for that piece from the beginning. And so it's a very promising intervention approach. This study sort of bolstered the body of evidence to more of to that promising evidence base according to Reichow's criteria for single subject design. And so since this work has happened, we've got a lot of buy-in from the school in Nova Scotia, and we've continued this work. So this year we're actually trying to find out if we can train adults who are already in the school system rather than a research trainer. Can we teach, you know, initially we wanted a speech-language pathologist, but it turns out that even though they'd be really ideally suited to implementing PRT because of the training with speech and language, they're too scarce in the school system. So they're only at schools, you know, once every couple of blocks or once every couple of weeks. And so what we ended up doing is training resource teachers or special education teachers this year in this approach. So they're the ones who are teaching the play coaches how to do this intervention in the school system. Fortunately, in Nova Scotia, there's been big teachers issues and a work to rule in place where they're striking, but so they're only doing core duties, they're not doing any other duties, so that's really put a stall to our research, fortunately, but that work is in place. It's just that it may take us a bit longer to get there. So again, we're trying to understand about this ecologically valid way to get this study done and to still understand more about the outcomes for children with ASD. And once we kind of have that established from experimental single subject design, then we can think about if it's still showing nice effects, thinking about making more large scale studies. So I would just like to say thank you to my doctoral supervisor, Dr. Isabel Smith, and my committee members, and Joe for hearing this talk one more time again, after recent consult as well. The IWK Health Center, which is a children's hospital in Nova Scotia, and the local school board in Nova Scotia, as well as the families who are part of this work. Thank you all for coming.